You're welcome back to The Breakfast on Plus TV Africa. It's now time for Off the Press with Mr. Tunde Kolawole. Good morning. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, good morning, my sister.
All right, let's begin with a punch.
Had a lovely weekend.
Yes, we did. Thank you. We hope you did too.
I did.
Fantastic. Fine. Let's begin with the Punch newspapers this morning. The headline reads, FG Vaccine Fund Runs Into Crisis. AstraZeneca scarcity hits India. Reuters reads, Nigeria may go for Pfizer, which costs $20 per dose. AstraZeneca, $4. WHO may review usage of expired COVID-19 vaccine for Nigeria and others. Above the headline on the Punch newspaper, review export proceeds repatriation policy, LCCI tells CBN. Akwa Ibom office attack, burning 345 ballot boxes, threaten 2023 polls. And that's according to INEC. Minimum wage, Ngige consults AGF, threatens to sue governors. Brent price slides, petrol landing cost hits 199.9 naira per liter. Below the headline on the Punch newspaper, we saved 45 northern youths from mob attack. And that's in Ondo State. And protest as Akwa Ibom fake recruiter killing job seeker. Afenifere was right by refusing to support Buhari, and that's according to Fashoranti. We've been servicing our first bank loans, says Honeywell. And NUJ kicks as Benue justifies arrest of journalists.
All right. Moving on to the Daily Independent this morning. Let's see what we can also find there. Top of the screen, you can see INEC says rising insecurity may affect 2023 elections. Confirms arsonists raised INEC office in Akwa Ibom. Gunmen kill policeman in Fresh Aboy station attack. Kill Kogi commissioner, abduct local government chairman. We can also find on the Daily Independent, banks NPLs escalate amid growth in gross loans to 20.48 trillion naira. Serap drags federal government to ECOWAS court over NBC code. And also, we have identified those behind mayhem in Imo State, says Uzodinma. COVID-19 surge, federal government bans travelers from Brazil, Turkey, India, reduces PCR tests to 72 hours. And also, Ondo government gives reasons for returning 42 boys to North. Why the APC must not return to power in 2023, says Fayoshe. And insecurity in Nigeria needs sincere actions and attitude change to survive, Muslim clerics are saying. I think these are the ones that we will be sharing this morning on the Daily Independent. One last one, it says here, BPE offers 5 NIPP Gencos for sale. Those are the big ones on the Daily Independent.
On the Nation newspaper, APC-PDP clash over worsening insecurity. The ruling party here is explaining what Buhari is doing about it. Policeman agency chief killed in Kogi and Ebonyi State. Governor Sule says we need US-UK rescue mission and can seek urgent attention. Above the headline on the Nation newspaper, governor to reveal Owerri attacks mastermind. Lady applicants raped, killed and buried in Uyo, police exhume body. Nigeria, others free to take more loans, says IMF. Below the headlines on The Nation, Labour queries NERC parameters for tariff review. Rates adjustments from July 1st. Herders destroying our farm, Ogun Bishop alleges. And Azman Air back. Nigeria, better together, says Tinubu. 2,000 CCTV cameras for Lagos. DSS warns against threats to security. And still on the Nation newspaper, 7 die in Lekki Epe Expressway accident. And Ondo sends 42 back to Kano and Jigawa. Those are the stories on the Nation newspaper.
The Nigerian Tribune up next. Nigeria owes China $3.7 billion, says the Debt Management Office. Freedom doesn't mean everything is permitted, says President Buhari. And also, Nigeria better together, says Tinubu. Insecurity, Nigeria drifting, live up to your responsibility, JNI tells federal government. Outrage over rape and murder of Akwa Ibom job seeker. Police intercept 13 guns, 753 GPMG ammunition in Ebonyi. Also, gunmen raid Akwa Ibom INEC office. We can also find here why we sent back 42 northern youths to Jigawa, Kano, and that's from the Ondo State Government. Afenifere justified for not supporting Buhari, Fasharanti says, at its 70th anniversary. And a few others, COVID-19 guidelines, airlines to pay $3,500 fine on each defaulting passenger. And also, why we won't call off strike until 19 billion naira is released, ASUP tells federal government. Those are the big ones on the Nigerian Tribune. Tunde Kolawole, let's have you in. There's a couple of very interesting stories that we've shared. Where would you like to start from?
Yeah, honestly speaking, most of the stories you have in the Nigerian newspapers today, and those we also hear on the electronic media like the television and the radio, are not scary at all. They are either stories of bankruptcy of the nation and corporations, or that of shedding of innocent people's blood, or that of dilapidated infrastructure all over the place, or that of admonition by kleptocratic politicians whose hands are tainted, not just with corruption, but with human blood. They are not the one recommending to us what is good for us as a people. But let me first and foremost start from the story of the lady who was lured and then killed in Akwa Ibom State. As a parent, that is a monumental disaster. It is a trauma that the parents will most likely not get over throughout their life. Imagine your daughter waking up in the morning and telling you that she's got an invitation to attend a job interview, only for you to be called upon to come and identify her body in the mortuary. There's nothing that can be more traumatic than that. The lesson from all of this is that we as individuals must educate our children on security consciousness, on what to watch out for, on also seeing not just the good things about the social media, but the danger that are hidden in there. For God's sake, I am shocked that one would just treat that she wants a job, and then you get an invitation, and you will rush down there without doing some due diligence, or even asking a male friend or a male relation or some other person to accompany you to such a place. If this lady has been security conscious, with due respect, maybe she might have been saved this ordeal. We must educate our children on the dangers of both the good nature and the inherent insecurity and the bad usage that social media could become. Secondly, it would appear to me that moral upbringing, tutoring our children on good culture, on good ethos, on having respect for each other and for human life, that we have totally lost it. Look at the number of girls. Look at the number of boys that have been killed through corruption. Look at the number of girls that have been lured and raped and killed. Look at the video that we have seen being played of a 14-year-old girl being molested in Lagos State. So if we have been alive to our responsibility as parents, we would have been teaching our parents that it is not a proper thing to do to rape a lady, to molest a lady, or even toy with human life. Nobody has any power whatsoever under the sun to take another person's life. Because the life is very sacred.
Mr. Kolawole, I think this issue about Hini is actually very dicey. Because, you know, even though you talked about security consciousness, the stories we've seen and the details you saw online shows she actually went during the day. She didn't go during the night. You know, she told people that she was going for this interview. It's not like she went in isolation, you know. And even apart from that, there have been cases we've seen online of people who, you know, accompanied, you know, other people for interviews, and they waited till night, they didn't see them. They called the police and found out that this person was killed right there and buried inside there. So really, how much security can we get? Or how much of a guarantee concerning security can we get in this country? Because it seems like most of the blame is on the victim, that the victim wasn't secure enough, the victim wasn't properly dressed. You know, how about, you know, just the general state of insecurity in the country and the moral decadence and level of crime, you know, of the perpetrators of these acts? I mean, why aren't we looking at that perspective?
Yeah, to be sure, there is no doubt about it that no matter how security conscious a person or a child might be in Nigeria today, he could feel vulnerable. He is even vulnerable to the kind of attack or to the kind of tragedy that befell the lady in Akwa Ibom State, simply because we no longer have respect for human life. And some of the infrastructures that we should have put in place to secure people, they are not there. Take, for example, in most cities, developed cities of the world, there are CCTV cameras that can pick out people's movement and make investigation very easy for the police or other security people to be able to do when there are issues. Furthermore, you find out children in primary and secondary school, universities and other, are taught how to be security conscious.
All right.
For some of these things we don't do around here.
Mr. Kolawole, you know, it's a conversation that can go on all day. I think, you know, we would leave it at calling for a more secure environment for Nigerians. And for the Nigerian police to also, you know, be properly equipped to be able to solve these cases as quickly as possible. You know, there's details like Aneta mentioned, you know, where she also did what she needed to do to be safe. But unfortunately, this is how we ended up. So let's not go too deep into it. Let's move on to a different story. Nigeria, of course, has banned flights from India, from Turkey and other countries, Brazil also. Do you think this is too little, too late? Should we have done this a lot earlier? And of course, are there fears of, you know, Nigeria also seeing a surge in COVID-19 cases?
We are a nation that is never proactive in anything. If we were proactive, the people should have the responsibility of saving the nation from this COVID pandemic will be on top of their game. They will be monitoring development from around the world, and anytime they spot danger, or anytime they see that some of these countries, COVID-19 is spiking over there, and because there is heavy volume of human committing or trapped, I mean, are moving from those countries to our own, we would have taken the appropriate measure. But lo and behold, like I said, we are never proactive. It is when these things have happened that we begin to react. And that is not good for us. Then, furthermore, our level of vaccination is not encouraging at all. A country like Israel has virtually vaccinated all our citizens, even though it is not a very large population. The population, I think, of about 8 or 10 million. But say, for example, a country like Britain, too, they have done almost about 30 million vaccinations. A detour for the Chinese people and all that. If we have also increase our vaccination rate and all that, a total lockdown, such as would affect Turkey, China, and some of this, India and all that, wouldn't have been called for, because the economy of Nigeria today depends on those three countries that we now want to shut out of Nigeria. Virtually everything that we consume in Nigeria today, especially in terms of technology, is coming from China. Virtually all the batteries and wearing apparel that we use in Nigeria today and spare parts are coming from Turkey. Indian companies are also active all over Nigeria, either in the area of construction, either in the area of they are now into estate business and building materials production. So because of this, we ought to have been more proactive in handling cases from some of these places. But it is never too late. We can still ramp up things and then find a way around this so that this thing doesn't too adversely affect us as a people. But the truth of the matter is the direction to go is for us to be able to produce our own vaccines. Nigeria has done it in the past, and we can still do it. We have the expertise to do it. There are so many drug manufacturing companies in Nigeria. There are so many virologists in our universities and teaching hospitals that we can put together and put money in their house for them to be able to produce a vaccine against COVID for us. If India can do it, I don't see why we cannot do it as a country. And you will also remember, in the beginning of this pandemic, they told us we were setting aside 10 billion naira to do research and look at the possibilities of producing a COVID vaccine in Nigeria. Now, a year after this, we are no longer hearing anything about that. We do hope that that money has not ended up in some people's pockets to the detriment of the nation.
Okay. So, Mr. Kolawole, there's another story here on the Punch newspaper. It says minimum wage Ngige consults AGF threatened to sue governors. So the president signed the 30,000 naira minimum wage into law in April 2019. And about 2 years, you know, after that, many states, you know, still struggle to pay that minimum wage, citing lots of, you know, factors. Now, Ngige is saying that he's going to, you know, he's threatening to sue governors who are yet to pay this minimum wage. But what do you think is the challenge, you know, with states and paying this minimum wage to workers?
Well, you would remember that most times when I talk on this your program, I've always been emphasizing the good governance. That without good governance, the different sectors of the Nigerian economy will not get whatever is due to them. That is what is playing out in the area of the minimum wage that we are talking about today. If a country becomes bankrupt due to poor management or lack of management at all, if a country begins to print money instead of working for money, where is that country going to be able to get the necessary funds to pay the minimum wage, as beautiful as it is? An agreement is also only enforceable when the means to really enforce it is there. But we now have a country that is bankrupt, that is allegedly, or that is alleged to be printing money, and you expect them to be able to pay the minimum wage. So I will recommend to Labour, when next time they are debating for things like this, it will be better, especially now that 2023 is at hand, for them to concentrate on good governance, to ensure that those who have the wherewithal, who have the expertise, who are not corrupt, who have respect for labor, are put in power, and not kleptocrats that we see all over the place. Then the second issue is, I am one of those who have been advocating that labor matters should be on the concurrent legislative list, and not on the exclusive legislative list as we have today. With the constitution that we have in our hand today, it is only the federal government that can legislate on labor. Whereas we do know that the states are even bigger employers of labor. So why you are not going to allow people who employ more labor have a say on whom they employ, how they employ, and what they pay, baffles me. Because what that is what it is meant when you put labor issue only on the exclusive legislative list. So we require to amend the constitution and put labor issues on the concurrent legislative list so that both the state and the federal government can legislate on labor issues. In fact, my take is the federal government should legislate on labor matters that is related, that has to do with federal government employees, while the state should legislate on labor issues that has to do with their own employees. Because a worker in a Lagos state is not the same as a worker in Jigawa or Safara state, for example. The cost of living in Lagos is far, far higher than the cost of living in Kogi state. But when you have a blanket law that says pay 20,000 minimum wage to a worker in Jigawa and to somebody in Lagos, you are not doing justice to these two categories of people. And I think that is not fair at all. Second one is, the third one is, even the 20,000 that we are talking about, will it take anybody home today? Is it enough to pay for transportation in an environment like Lagos? Sometimes the PACN people will bring a PACN bill of 20,000 naira to a household of one or two persons for a mini flat or even for a room and parlor set container and all that. If the person staying in that kind of an apartment is on a 20,000 minimum wage, how is he going to be able to pay for his energy consumption? How is he going to pay his rent?
All
how
right.
is he going to pay for transportation? How is he going to be able to feed himself?
Okay.
The way and manner the energy issues are being handled today is totally anti the ordinary man, totally avowed, totally against,
okay.
totally not in the interest of the poor people in the society. In fact, what we are saying is that the poor people in Nigeria today who are supposed to be earning 20,000 minimum wage are not entitled to the good things of life.
Okay, thank you very much. I think that's all the time we have this morning for Off the Press. Thank you for your time and thank you for starting off our Monday with us.
Yes,
good
thank
morning,
you.
Tunde Kolawole.
Thanks for having me. Thanks for always being there for me.
All
thanks
right.
for always being there for the Nigerian people.
Thank
Absolutely.
You.
Stay with us. Of course, from Off the Press, we're moving straight to telling you about today in history. What happened on this day many years ago? I'm going back to the year 2008, and we're talking once again something that we had shared last week about a similar occurrence of a bombing that took place on this day in 2008.
And we're going back a year earlier in 2007 to tell you about the story of the most reported missing person case in history. Do stay with us.